because I've been told with this funny little black mic, it looks like I have a missing tooth. But I don't. My teeth are all here, present and accounted for. So, just to let everyone know, side note. Anyway, you glad to be at church this morning?
Yes.
I am super glad. Let's stand and just worship this morning together.
Yeah.
Is it me or is that choir keep getting bigger every week?
Amen.
So, it's good to see the choir back. And,
amen.
Y'all like my shirt? How many of y'all ordered one of these? A lot of people are asking me, well, why'd you get yours? And I didn't get mine. So the shirts are in, and Lynn, where are you at? The back. You're going to distribute those next week, right? Starting Tuesday. So you, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, she'll be available next Sunday, right? So you can get your shirt. So just see Lynn if you want your shirt. So I'm just modeling them, that's all. I'm a professional modeler. So anyway, last week we talked about Lydia. We talked about the story in which she got saved, where Paul went and ministered and taught to a small group of women, and she got saved. And we talked about how can a small church, or how can a small group make an impact for Jesus? And we concluded with this nugget that the best ability is availability. We talked about just being available to do what God has you to do. Now today, we've got Joe Sanger, and he is coming to speak. He is the owner and president of Enjoy Ministries, which we have used for our capital campaign to expand our worship center. And the thing about it is, I remember Joe many years ago, Kathy and I, we actually took his class. He wrote a book called I Was Broke, But Now I'm Not. Can anybody kind of relate to that? I can relate to both of those. And so we took his class when Kathy and I were in our 20s. So that was like a number of years ago. And we really enjoyed that. He was at New Spring at the time, and so we took that class with about 1,500 other people. It seemed like there was a lot of people in there taking that class. But if you have not signed up, we're having that class 1 to 3. We're providing lunch at 12 o'clock, so that's going to be in the fellowship hall. So love for you to be a part of that. And what I liked about his class is, how many of you are familiar with a guy named Dave Ramsey? Okay. Yep, you've heard of him. What I like more about Joe's approach is it was very, very practical. And so good practical advice that all of us can implement. So just want to kind of talk about that. But he's going to be also giving us a word today. And I just want to share this quick verse and then we'll pray. In Psalm 5:7 it says, "But I enter your house by the abundance of your faithful love. I bow down towards your holy temple in reverent awe of you." Are you in reverent awe of God? I mean, think about who God is and what all He has done. I mean, Genesis 1:1 starts out, "In the beginning God created the heavens and the earth." If you just let that sink in for a moment. Because we know how big the world is, and we know how big the Milky Way galaxy is. But think about it, there are millions of other galaxies that are even bigger than our galaxy. And in one sentence, it summed it up. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Our God is an awesome God, and we should be in reverence of Him. And that's what we're going to do today as we worship Him. Let's start out in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, thank You for this day. Thank You for each and every person that is here. And Father, I just pray that You will bless them, that You will be here in our service this morning, that You will be with us, and that You will penetrate our hearts, and we will leave different than the way we came in. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning, Cedarwood.
Welcome to church.
Is this your first time here at Cedarwood? If so, we would like to get to know you better. We invite you to fill out a connection card located on the seat in front of you, and after the service, take it to the welcome desk in the foyer. A member of our church family will be there to greet you, and we have a gift to thank you for choosing to worship with us today.
Here are a few things you need to know.
Be sure to sign up to bring a side dish for our church-wide Thanksgiving dinner next week, November 20th, after Sunday school. Copies of next year's budget will be available in the foyer after the service. If you have any questions, there'll be time for discussion on Wednesday evening before Bible study. The next women's event will be December 10th at 10 a.m. We will have a cookie exchange and be making an ornament.
That's everything you need to know for this week.
Thank you for choosing the worship.
I never said that I would give you silver or gold, or that you would never feel a fire or shiver in the cold. But I did say you'll never walk through this world alone. And I did say, don't make this world your home. I never said that fear wouldn't find you in the night, or that loneliness was something you'd never have to fight. But I did say I'll be right here by your side. And I did say I'll always help you find. 'Cause you know I made a promise that I intend to keep. My grace will be sufficient in the time of need. I want you to be the anchor that you can hold on to. This is the promise. This is the promise that I've made to you. I never said that friends would turn their backs on you, or that the world around you wouldn't treat you as a fool. But I did say, like me, you'll surely be beside. But I did say, my ways confound the wise. I didn't say you'd never taste the bitter kiss of death. How could all you chilly Jordan to enter into rain? But I did say I'll be waiting right on the other side. Yeah. And I did say I'll cry every tear you cry. 'Cause you know I made a promise that I'll prepare the way. And someday sooner than you think, you'll see me face to face. And you'll sing with the angels that God has called us to. This is the promise. This is the promise I made to you. Don't turn to the left or right. And in the midst of darkness, let this be your light. And help in somewhere else, you're gonna make it through. This is the promise. This is the promise I made to you. Oh, this is the promise. This is the promise I made to you.
beautiful song.
Amen.
I had never heard that one before, but the words were really powerful. And it's funny how, as a worship leader, you can try to plan music out, but then you realize as you sit back, God always orchestrates it. Because we sang first, just a closer walk with thee. And really, that's what that was about, that same song, about walking with God and the promises that he keeps when we do that. And as we start worship with everybody this morning, we're going to sing a song called Graze into Gardens. And, you know, I was just thinking as he was singing that, how the promises he keeps, we don't always get to experience the garden right here on earth. Sometimes we do have to suffer through some things, but the promise is the garden does come. You know, but at the same time, I'm going to tell you what, it's in the hardest times that I find myself closest to God. And that alone is a garden experience. So let's praise him this morning for turning the graves into gardens for us. So stand with us as we worship this morning.
sun comes up, it's a new day dawn. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before you, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship your holy name. You're rich in love and you're so tempting. I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to cry. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like
prepared for this weekend. Excited to be with you today. And I've been able to join you on services online with the miracle of YouTube. And been able to watch the services and really enjoyed the message that's been delivered on the book of Acts. Today I'm going to be in the book of Acts again as we continue, but we're going to take a little bit of a backtrack to chapter 4. And today I want to be very clear. I'm going to talk about money today. Who's fired up about that? Three people are, that's awesome. And I will talk about giving. Even better, right? Yeah. It's actually going to be a great message. I think you're going to really enjoy it. Because this is the season of giving, isn't it? It's the season of Thanksgiving that we're headed to. It's a very good reminder. And in Acts 4, chapter 4, verses 32 through 37 is where we're going to focus today. And it says, all the believers were one in heart and mind. No one claimed that any of their possessions was their own, but they shared everything they had. With great power, the apostles continued to testify to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus. And God's grace was so powerfully at work in them all that there were no needy persons among them. For from time to time, those who owned land or houses sold them, brought the money from the sales, and put it at the apostles' feet, and it was distributed to anyone who had need. Joseph, a Levite from Cyprus, whom the apostles called Barnabas, which means son of encouragement, sold a field he owned and brought the money and put it at the apostles' feet. That's the word of the Lord. I'm grateful for it. Today, we're going to talk about things that happen when we give. And there's a lot of things that happen when we choose to give. But I'm going to focus on three of them. Before we dive into the message, I do want to tell you a little bit about my background, because I think it helps inform why I'm passionate about this topic. First off, I grew up in Indiana. I'm a Midwesterner. Just south of Indianapolis, Indiana, in the middle of a cornfield. Has anybody ever been to Indiana? Anybody ever been there? If you've seen a cornfield, you've seen Indiana. Muncie, there we go. And so I grew up there. My mother and father had four boys. They really wanted a daughter. They were desperate for a daughter. So when the youngest was about 5 years old, they got another baby on the way. And they prayed it would be their daughter. And on March 31st, what's the day after March 31st? April Fool's Day. This is relevant to the story. My mother went into labor, and she went to the hospital, and the nurse was checking on the womb on the baby with the stethoscope, because that's how they checked on babies back then. And she got this really worried look and went and got the doctor and said, there's something wrong with this baby's heartbeat. And the doctor came and listened, and he listened for a couple seconds, and then he broke into a broad smile and said, there's nothing wrong with the baby's heartbeats. There's two of them. This is 2 hours before April Fool's Day at 10 p.m. My mother said what I think any mother would say at that moment. She said, I rebuke you in the name of Jesus. I'm going to have one baby, and it better be a girl, or I'm sending it back. And the doctor said, I don't know about the boy or girl part, but you're going to have two. Get ready. And so a half hour later, my identical twin brother was born. And 7 minutes later, I was born. She didn't cheer either. She cried, said, the Lord has spoken. If we try for a daughter again, we'll have triplet boys. So we're through with this. So I'm the baby of six boys. And so I grew up in a household where there wasn't a lot of extra money floating around. I don't know if any of you have ever had that situation, but we kind of, my dad says he remembers driving the old family automobile. We had one big family automobile. It was a 1974 Oldsmobile Delta 88 Royale. Does anybody remember one of those? It's a big old land yacht. Yeah. And they had a rule. The kids don't sit up front with mom and dad. So all six of us would pile on the back seat. So no seat belts were involved in this at all. And we would get into that back seat, and me and my twin, being the youngest, got to choose between sitting on the hump or in the back window. Anybody know the hump where the transmission goes under there? And miraculously, we survived without seat belts. But here's what I know. My dad says he remembers looking in that rearview mirror at times and seeing six little sets of eyes staring at him. He's like, I am going to be broke forever. How do I feed these six boys? And then he had the moment of inspiration with the light bulb going off and said, I can put them to work growing our food. And so we got the joy of growing our food. And every springtime, without consulting my schedule, my mother announced that it was time to plant the garden. And despite my best efforts, the garden would grow. And then we would plant a whole acre of sweet corn, a half acre of green beans. And we put up hundreds of quarts of green beans a year. So we did not lack for food, but we had green beans a lot, right? How do you want your eggs at breakfast? Here's a scoop of green beans, very special. But that kind of informs, you know, how you grow up. The situation you grow up in informs how you view money, doesn't it? So when I grew up, we didn't see a lot of money. And so the only time I heard about money was when my mom and dad were frustrated by it. And although I went to church Sunday morning, Sunday night, and I went Tuesday night and Thursday night too, and when there was a Friday night youth service, my mother recommended we go to that too, I never heard a message taught about the rest of the money. That God owned it all, and that God owns the giving, and He also owns the rest. And so I ventured off in life and I went to college. I'm the first in my family to go to college, and I went to Purdue University studying mechanical engineering, and by a miracle of God, I graduated. I did not get an A in any engineering classes. Be glad God called me out of that. My stuff would injure someone. I graduated special honors. Some graduated magna cum laude or summa cum laude. I graduated, thank the laude, and got out of there. But anyhow, I moved to South Carolina in 1998 with a job transfer. And I ended up enrolling and found the Lord and went to Clemson University. And got my MBA, my master's in business. But God had me actually here to help start a church. And we ended up helping plant a church and ended up seeing that church grow. And we really got to see the profound effects of what happens when we choose to give. And today, I'm going to kind of share three of those things that happen. If you're going to take notes today, the first thing that happens when we give is we honor God. The first thing, every time that we choose to give, it honors the Lord. In fact, we see that when we give, it causes us to acknowledge ownership. You know, nothing of what we possess is ours, right? It's not ours. Psalm 24:1 affirms that. It says, the earth is Lord's and everything in it, the world and all who live in it. It's all His. I own a farm down here in Abbeville, maybe 36 minutes away, I think it is. And I love to go on this farm. It's awesome. There's a deer infestation problem. There's a turkey infestation problem. And, oh, yeah, I see somebody getting slain in the spirit over here. It's awesome. It's of the Lord. But, you know, when I'm walking on this property, as I'm walking on the property, I discovered an old car. I took a picture of it and sent it to my dad. And he said, well, I need you to dig it out of the ground a little bit. It's either a 48 or a 49 Chevy. And it's just sitting in the middle of the woods. It looks like one of the mobster's vehicles. In fact, maybe the mob used it because both doors are open and there's gunshots in the back of it. But you know one thing that I know about that is it tells me someone possessed this land before my name was on the deed. And if the Lord tarries, somebody else's name will be on it long after I'm gone. I'm just a manager. And so are you. We're just managers. In fact, I love what it says there in verse 32 of our scripture today. It says, all the believers were one in heart and mind. No one claimed that any of their possessions was their own, but they shared everything they had. They really viewed it as the Lord's. And if God called it, they were willing to give it. And I came today to ask you that question is, everything that you possess, whatever it might be, do you view it as yours or do you view it as the Lord's? And if He asked for you to give it, would you be able to let go? Some of you are able to answer the question rapidly. Sometimes, all of us being human, we struggle with that, don't we? Because we want to do this. But if the Lord provided, right, as Job said in Job 1:21, He says, the Lord gives and the Lord takes away. Blessed be the name of the Lord.
Amen.
He and then later on, we know that Job was blessed greater in his latter days than in his former days. That the Lord, our Jehovah Jireh, the great provider, He will give again. If He's asking us to give, He would never ask us to give without continuing to meet our needs. When we give, we honor God. There's a great story that I ran across where it said an old country preacher asked a farmer in his congregation, he asked this farmer, he said, if you had 100 cows, would you be willing to give 50 of them to the Lord? And the farmer replied, of course I would, preacher, I would be willing to do that. He said, what if you had 100 horses, asked the preacher, would you be willing to give 50 of those horses to the Lord? Again, the farmer replied, oh yes, I would give 50 horses to the Lord. And then the preacher asked, what if you had 2 pigs? Would you give one to the Lord? He said, that's not fair, preacher, said the farmer. You know I have 2 pigs. I love that story. Do you know what I love about that story? We always, as humans, will say, if the Lord gives us this big blessing, then I will. But when we think about the right here, right now, we always have an objection. I do. And I remember when God was calling me into full-time ministry, and I knew that that was going to, you know, allow me to negotiate a massive pay cut, get fired up, where I was going to store up more treasure in heaven. I started making deals with God. Well, God, if you could just let me pay off my house first. Have you ever done any of these deal making with God? But here's what I know. When God calls us to do something, it is for that season, for that moment, and you don't want to miss it. And when we give, we honor God. And when we acknowledge that fact, it becomes relevant to our lives right here, right now, not somewhere in the distant future. Well, it moves greatly in our hearts. It changes how we view everything we have. I ran across this great quote. It's from a book written in the 1850s. Became a runaway smash Broadway hit. Some of you may have watched it. It's written by Victor Hugo. The name of the play? I'm not French, in case you can't tell. Les Misérables. It looks like Les Miserables to me. But Victor Hugo is writing about the issue of poverty in the city of Paris. And he wrote this statement, which is really the gospel. He says, and I'll put it on the screen here. He says, you can give without loving, but you can never love without giving. Think about that. The great acts of love are done by those who are habitually performing small acts of kindness. We pardon to the extent that we love. And love is knowing that even when you're alone, you'll never be lonely again. And great happiness of life is a conviction that we are loved. Love for ourselves, and even loved in spite of ourselves. I love that line, you can give without loving, right? My son is in the Boy Scouts. Many of you have bought popcorn from the Boy Scouts. You gave money, a bunch of money, for a very little amount of popcorn, right? Because it's supporting something good. You gave. You may not love it, but you gave. But when you think about your kids, think about, you're compelled to give to them, aren't you? Pastor was commenting on the most beautiful child he's ever seen this morning. The most beautiful child. It turns out it might be a grandchild. And I did hear that good looks and intelligence skip generations. It's really weird. Straight from grandpa. No. But here's what I would just say is that it is very important for us to understand that why we give, well, our heart is there. And how can a person say, I love the Lord, and not be a giver? It is an impossibility. And you can't grow close to the Lord without becoming a giver of your time, of your talent, and indeed of your treasure. When we give, we honor God. The second thing that happens when we give is when we give, we bless people. We bless people. Never forget that when you give, you bless people. I love the end of verse 33 and the start of verse 34, the whole sentence there. It says, and God's grace was so powerfully worked in them all. Who wants God to work powerfully in your life? Anybody want to see God working powerfully? I do. And it says that there were no needy persons among them. One of the results of God moving in them was that there was no need amongst people. How amazing is that? That it compelled them to give. When we give, we bless people. I experienced this early in my life, and it's had a profound impact. You can imagine my parents having this surprise gift of two boys, twins, identical twins that they couldn't hardly tell apart, having six boys. The oldest boy was 14 years old when we were born. So by the time we turned 18 and were graduating high school, they had had boys in the house for 32 consecutive years, and they were over it. Has anybody ever been over it with kids in the house? Anybody? It's like Proverbs 22:6 becomes the theme verse. Train a child the way they should go. Emphasis added by you, right? It's time to leave. Come back with those grandkids, right? It's awesome. But here's what I know. They threw a high school graduation party for us, and it quickly became apparent that the party was for them, not for us. I don't remember any gifts that were given except for two. The first one was the gift from my parents, which was luggage. We love you, pack up, get out. Congratulations. And then the second gift really had a profound impact on me. And it was from my friend Jason's mother. Let me tell you about my friend Jason's mother. Her name was Evie. Evie was an immigrant. She had met a U.S. soldier overseas. They fell in love, got married, came back to the States. She barely knew the English language. They had four children, boom, 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 boom. And for reasons unknown to me, her husband left and never came back. I don't know any of the background of that story. It left them in utter poverty. Let me help you understand. Free government food, 100% paid for housing, the Indiana Hoosiers basketball coach Bob Knight mailed shoes to this family every year because he heard of their challenges. It was poverty. But it was just my friend Jason and his brothers and his sisters and his mom. And I remember his mother had some critical chronic health issues, but she was awesome. And every time we would show up at church, there she would be with her four children. And we would go spend time in at their house, and we grew up together. And I remember moments where we'd play a game called Spoons. I don't know if you ever played a game called Spoons, and some amazing games like that. And she would be sitting there in the back corner just happy, seeing her kids happy. And I remember at my graduation, she came to me and my twin brother, and she gave each of us a card. And in the card was a single dollar bill. And she hurriedly told me in her broken English that she had ironed the dollar bill so that it would look new. And I remember in that moment, just being profoundly impacted. And I remember jumping up, she was about this tall, and giving her a big hug. And then like saying to my twin brother, how do you spend the dollar? You can't spend that dollar. And I remember putting it away, and in the course of five or six moves, I had no idea where the dollar was, and I was inspired about 2 or 3 years ago to try to find it. And so I went up into the attic and I started pulling out boxes trying to find this dollar. And guess what box I found it in? Yeah, the last one. And I found it was in the bottom of the last one. But I remember the moment I saw it, the emotion of that moment showed up again, and I opened it up, and there was this dollar, and it had her name signed on it. I have a picture of it here. I actually had it framed in my office. And that's the dollar. Has her name there, Evie Riley, and I actually put Mark 12, 41 through 44 below it. Let me tell you what Mark 12, 41 through 44 says. It says, Jesus sat down. If people would say, if you ever hear a person say, Jesus doesn't care what people give, just take them to Mark 12, watch this. Jesus sat down opposite the place where the offerings were put and watched the crowd putting their money into the temple treasury. Many rich people threw in large amounts. Amen, glory, hallelujah. But a poor widow came and put in two very small copper coins worth only a few cents. Calling his disciples to them, Jesus said, truly I tell you, this poor widow has put more into the treasury than all the others. They all gave out of their wealth, but she, out of her poverty, put in everything, all she had to live on. How amazing is that? And this is where we learn this key that it is not how much we give, but it's how much we give in proportion to how God has blessed us. A gift of $5 can be the same as a gift of $5 million, depending on the proportion. Does that make sense? And so what I would just say is, I don't know what your situation is, but I would just say, give as the Lord compels you, knowing that it always will end up resulting in the blessing of people. It will honor God and it will bless people. Think about all the ministries here. I was listening to the message last week and talking about Lydia and talking about how a small church can make big impact. And hearing about the Grief Share ministry and the AA ministry that I saw on the sign this morning. And the weekly ministry that happens all throughout the week that's taking place because somebody had a vision to start this church as a place to worship the Lord and minister to a community. See it all the fun that the primetimers have and the journey to hope. Here's what I know. Whenever you give, it always blesses people. Never ever forget it. In fact, when Jenny and I were trying to get our financial budget together, I went to Purdue University, and you know, I didn't have any money. And so I started dating this girl known as Sally Mae, student loan company. Does anybody know her? Maybe you know some of her first cousins. So I financed all my college education. My first week in there, I filled out all these credit card applications because they said they'd give me free stuff. And so I filled them all out. I even admitted I had no job and no income, but they sent me a credit card. And the next day, I practiced with it. Should have employed that wisdom from the kids show that says, swiper, no swiping, come on, Vominos, everybody, let's go. And so by the time I graduated college, I had thousands of dollars in credit card debt, tens of thousands in student loan debt, and then I graduated, I've been driving a 1981 Datsun B210. Yeah. It had a hole in the passenger side floorboard, the dash had collapsed, it had caught on fire twice. Very special. So I went and bought myself a new car. I even financed a sales tax. 105% financing for a new car. Isn't that awesome? And then I found this lost book of the Bible, the first book of Hesitations, chapter 3, verse 2. It says every guy needs a truck. Now, I made that up. But I bought a truck, 100% financing. And then I asked my college sweetheart to marry me, and she said yes, so I financed the engagement ring, the wedding, and the honeymoon to Jamaica, all on the credit card. Yeah. And then I moved to South Carolina, and we bought a house. I don't know how we managed that, but then we needed furniture, and based on my track record, do you think we paid cash for that furniture? No, 24 months same as cash, we had some furniture. And so here's what I'm saying is that we ran up all of our spending, and as a result, it started to rob us of the ability to give. Excuse me. Pursuing the things that I wanted robbed us of the ability to give. And so we decided we would put together a budget, and we put together this budget, and we put God first with the tithe, and we put another line item. If I could get some water, that'd be great. Sorry. Somehow choked up here. The second line item was something that said intentionally bless others. And we put money in the budget every month to bless others. You have... my voice is messing up. Yeah, I don't need a cough drop, but water would be great. But I'll just take a... Here, I'll take my coffee. That would be great. Coffee would be perfect. Thanks so much. There we go. Yes. So, you do have a budget, right? Some of you are like, maybe not. Well, that's what this afternoon's event, the financial learning experience, is about getting a budget that will actually work well. And so we have over 100 free financial tools. That's why we're teaching it. And so I encourage you, always put God first. And then I encourage you to put a line called intentionally bless others in your budget.
Amen.
And it turns out, if you put a line item in your budget called intentionally bless others, we pull it out in cash and carry it with us. Amen. God will give you opportunities to bless others. And you may not be able to start with a lot. But here's what I would tell you. Start with what you have, where you're at. And watch how God will multiply that. Amen? Awesome. The third thing that happens when we give... Thank you so much, Pastor. I don't know what happened here. I got a small frog here. when we give, we honor God. When we give, we bless people. And the third thing, when we give, we are blessed. We ourselves are blessed. Acts 4:32 says, all the believers were one in heart and mind, and no one claimed that any of their possessions were their own, but they shared everything they had. Think about this. They shared. And they were all one in heart and mind. Did you know unity is a gift from God? Being able to have peace and unity is one of the greatest gifts you can ever have. And you can see that that happened with the believers here. In fact, in verses 33 and continuing to verse 34, it says, with great power, the apostles continued to testify to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus. And God's grace was so powerfully at work in them all, that there were no needy persons among them. So they were able to testify with great power. Many of you have members of your family who are far from the Lord, and you would love for them to be able to hear the gospel, but it seems like every time you try to have that conversation, it's like you're chiding them, and they kind of put their fingers in the ears and they don't want to hear. Well, let me tell you, what happens when you are able to testify with great power is it will plant a seed. Even if they don't want to hear, they will still hear it. And it may plant a seed that may not germinate for years, but it will give you that great power. And it says, God's grace was so powerfully at work in them all, and it resulted in no one needing anything. When you grow in your walk with the Lord, you can't help but become more generous. You can't help it. I love what 1 Timothy 6, 17 through 19 says. Paul wraps it up so well in this great chapter on giving. He says, command those who are rich in this present world. Who's rich here this morning? Is anybody rich? We should all raise our hands, by the way. We're all very wealthy. Most of us have not unintentionally missed a meal in a while. Many of us have houses for our cars, and they're bigger than most people's houses they have for themselves. Think about it. You know, our garages, right? So we're all rich. So he's talking to us, tells us not to be arrogant, nor to put our hope in wealth, which is so uncertain, but to do what? But to put their hope in, help me, put their hope in God. And what does he do? Who richly provides us with everything for our enjoyment. Command them to do good, to be rich in good deeds, to be generous and willing to share. In this way, they will lay up treasure for themselves as a firm foundation for the coming age, so they may take hold of a life that is truly life. I want to leave this verse up here for a minute, because what I think is awesome here is he's giving us really two don'ts and five do's. Let's look at the don'ts in there. What does he say? Don't be arrogant. You see it? Command them to not be arrogant. Nor to put their what? Hope in wealth. It is so uncertain. Can I get a witness that wealth is uncertain? Anybody remember 2007, 8, 9 when your 401k turned into a 201k and then into a box of Special K? Can I get a witness? And it's at least turned into a 301k over the last year and a half, right? It's uncertain, right? But then he gives you five do's. What are they? Put your hope in God. Why? He richly provides us with everything for our enjoyment. And then do good, be rich in good deeds, be generous, be willing to share. Do you see what he's saying? Be generous. You cannot outgive God. It's impossible. And as you grow closer to the Lord, and he sees that you have an open-handed life, what he can flow through you, he will get to you. Amen? And so I encourage you, in summary, that when we give, let's think about these three things. And I want you to think about it through this whole season of giving through the rest of the year. As you think about this capital campaign of Imagine More, of what's happening in Cedarwood, I want you to be thinking about the fact that every time you give, you honor the Lord. Every time. Every time you give, it blesses people. And you may not meet those people on this side of glory. You may only hear about it over there. And when you give, you are blessed. And so my challenge for each one of us, as we go through this season of giving, is what is it that the Lord has placed in your hands, and what would he like you to do with it? How would he like you to leverage it for his kingdom, for your good, for his glory? I'll wrap it up with the story of what happened through giving in our life and how it has been a great move in our family. As we were planting this new little church in Anderson, we planted on the corner of Anderson College up in Anderson when it was just a college. It's all grown up now. It's a university. But we were meeting in the chapel, and it was 2000, and we had this economic recession. Anybody remember the dot-com bubble? And they decided that they were going to stimulate the economy. And President Bush decided that they were going to send $300. Does anybody remember this? It's actually $600, I believe. $600 to each person in the family. To each taxpayer. Does anybody remember this? Some of you don't remember this. You weren't born then. But I guess I'm getting old. But they came to this moment. The stimulus stuff did not just start with coronavirus. They did it way back in 2000. And they were going to send us this money. Now, we were broke. Because we had the spiritual gift of making money disappear. We are talented spenders. Anybody here have that gift? And so we had been spending it up. But we got this gift, and this money was coming. We didn't know which day it was going to show up. But my bride's mother called and said, she was talking with her daughter and said, what are you guys going to do with that money? What are you going to buy? And my bride said, well, we're just going to give it to our church. We're taking some next steps. And people are showing up and we're going to give it. And my mother-in-law says that at that moment, it totally threw her back. Because her whole mindset was, how can I spend this? And she's talking to her daughter, and her daughter's saying she's going to give it. Amen. And give it to a church. And it has caused her to lean in more fully to the work of the Lord in her life. And as a result, you know, at the end of the day, she's ended up moving 13 hours away from where she lived in northern Indiana, lived 5 minutes away from us, has got plugged into our church, and still says that that was one of the pivotal moments in her life of renewing and restoring her faith.
Amen.
Because her daughter chose to give. Hey, may that happen for you sometime during this season. Amen? Can I pray for us? Lord, I thank you so much for every single person that's here today. Lord, I thank you that you do provide. Lord, you provide in miraculous ways. And Lord, I know there are people here with needs. I know that you can meet them. Remind them that you are Jehovah Jireh, the great provider of it all. And Lord, I know that there are marriages here where people are fighting over money. May they be able to have a productive conversation about money. Maybe the first productive conversation that they've been able to have in years. And Lord, for those who've never truly tested you in this area of giving, may you give them the confidence to know that when they give, it will honor you, and it will bless people, and it will position them for blessing. And then, Lord, I do pray for those that are far from you. Lord, we thank you, Jesus, that you died, you paid a debt that none of us could ever repay, and that you paid that debt of sin, and you give us that free gift of generosity, that generosity unexplained of salvation. Lord, we'll never get over it. Lord, I pray that anyone who's never called upon you, that they would call on your name today. Lord, make you Lord of their life. Jesus, we love you. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
get everybody to sit down for a second. Joe, we thank you for coming and bringing the word this morning.
Amen.
And talking about everybody's favorite subject, right? God and money. So I have somebody up here, if y'all didn't notice. This is Debbie, okay? And Debbie, you said you like these people, right? You want to come be a part of our family. So she wants to come and join. Now, Debbie, you're originally from where?
Belton.
She's originally from Belton. So she wants to join, so I need to get a motion. Got a motion from David. I need a second. Got a second from Rich. Now, all in favor, I'm going to count to three, and I want you to say amen. They got to hear them in Belton, okay? So y'all got to have to belt one out, all right? One, two, three.
Amen!
You think they heard it?
Yeah, I think so.
Okay, all right, we're good. So Debbie will be up here. Y'all come and just welcome her and introduce yourself, and then we'll give her the test to make sure she knows everybody's name at the end. And just to kind of put things together, she is Donna's sister, just so you know. So, and if you're here and you're visiting, you're looking for a Sunday school class, you can see me, you can see Christine. We'll be happy to point in that direction. Lynn has evidently gone somewhere else. I would point in her direction to help you that. But we'd be happy to help you find a Sunday school class. What we do now is we go over to the fellowship hall for a time of fellowship. And there'll be some snacks there. And then we break up, go to our Sunday school class at 11 o'clock. So if you're wondering what to do next. Now, if you are taking the I was broke, but now I'm not class, that class is 1 to 3, but right after Sunday school, we'll meet in the fellowship hall, and we are providing lunch. If you have not signed up, come anyway, okay? We'll figure out how to make food go further. Jesus did it, but we'll just not eat as much. But y'all come and join us for that, and we'll start as soon as everybody's through eating, even if we start a bit earlier. So we will do that, and it should last a couple of hours. So love for you guys to be a part of that. So let's close in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, again, we thank you for this day. Thank you for Joe and the word that he has brought to us. We thank you for the music. We just think about this time that we came to glorify and to praise you. And just be with us next week as we come back. And I ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.